Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. We'll talk more about peritoneal terms in this lecture, which includes mesentery, which includes peritoneal ligaments. What are peritoneal ligaments? Which includes peritoneal folds. What are they? And peritoneal recesses or fossa. Mesentery, which we have partly covered in our last lecture, mesentery is the fold of peritoneum, which is arising from the viscera and going along with the viscera inside the peritoneal cavity, and this covering the visceral peritoneum. This mesentery contains the blood vessels. It's a neurovascular bundle. Blood vessels which are arising outside the extraperitoneum. Nerves and lymphatics, and they are carrying to the viscera. And the foregut, embryologically, you have got two mesentery, one on the ventral side and one on the dorsal side. But in the midgut, the mesentery is on the dorsal side, small bowel mesentery. The large gut is also attached to the abdominal wall, some part of the large gut, that is transverse and pelvic sigmoid colon, transverse colon and sigmoid colon. They are attached by mesentery, and those are known as mesocolon, transverse mesocolon and pelvic mesocolon. And wherever the mesentery is attached, that part of the gut is freely mobile. Now we come to the peritoneal ligaments. Peritoneal ligaments are peritoneal connections between the two viscera. Now let's take the example of the liver. Liver is over here, that's the liver, and the liver is connected with the anterior abdominal wall, number one, that's the anterior abdominal wall, by a ligament which is known as the falciform ligament. Falciform ligament, anterior abdominal falciform ligament, and the lower edge of the falciform ligament, he has got the ligamentum teres, which is the obligated umbilical vein, ligamentum teres, falciform ligament. Then the liver is also connected to the stomach by ligaments. This is nothing else but the what we talked earlier of, that is the stomach is over here. Let me draw it over here. That's the stomach. So the liver is connected with the stomach by a membrane which is known as the lesser omentum. This lesser omentum. And this lesser omentum has got two parts. One part which is attached from the liver to the stomach. This part is known as the hepatico-duodenal parts, hepatogastric part, liver to the stomach, hepatogastric parts, and the one part which is attached to the duodenum, that's the duodenum. This is known as hepatoduodenal ligament, hepatoduodenal ligament. So it's same structure, but descriptively it is divided into hepatoduodenal and hepatogastric. Hepatoduodenal has got the free edge. This is the free edge. And this contains the porta hepatis, common bile duct, portal vein and hepatic artery. And this, there is an opening behind. That is known as the opening foramen of Winslow. If you put your finger inside, you will go into the lesser sac. That is known as the foramen of Winslow. We enter from the greater sac into the lesser sac. That's the hepatoduodenal ligament. Now the stomach is connected to diaphragm. Let's show the connection of the stomach over here. Liver is here. Diaphragm would be nearby. So the stomach over here is connected to the diaphragm. Which is known as gastrophrenic ligament. Stomach going from stomach to the diaphragm, gastrophrenic ligament. And then you got is connected to the spleen. Our spleen is on the lateral side. So it's connected to the spleen. That is the gastrosplenic ligament. And finally, it is connected to the transverse colon. It goes lower down. And then it reflects back to the transverse colon. So this part is known as the gastrocolic ligament. This is gastrocolic. This is gastrosplenic, and that's the gastrophrenic. Now this all is the greater omentum. All of this is greater omentum. And for descriptive purposes, they are divided into gastrophrenic component, gastrosplenic component, and gastrocolic ligament. So these are the peritoneal ligaments. And then we come to the peritoneal folds and peritoneal fossas and peritoneal recesses. Peritoneal folds are folds of peritoneum which are raised because of underlying structure. Now this diagram shows the peritoneal folds. This is in the midline. This diagram is inside the abdominal wall, inside of the anterior abdominal wall. And this is umbilicus, and this is one peritoneal fold. Because of the structure underlying, this structure is the urethrus, which is communicating with the bladder. Urethrus. Congenitally, it is communicating with the bladder and then it gets obliterated. That's the midline fold. On either side of the midline fold, this is known as the median fold. On either side of the midline fold are these another folds over here, one over here, one over here. These are known as the medial umbilical fold. And they contain obliterated vessels. This also contains obliterated vessels, umbilicus. And then there is a third fold, more laterally. This is the lateral umbilical fold, this one. This is lateral umbilical fold. And this contains the inferior epigastric vessels. So folds are nothing but raised part of the peritoneum because of the structures underlying it. Median umbilical fold, medial umbilical fold, and lateral umbilical fold. And these are seen on the inner side of the anterior abdominal wall. Inner side of the abdominal. And lastly, we come to the peritoneal recesses. Now, peritoneal recesses are recesses between the peritoneal folds, or between the peritoneal attachment. Now that's the, here you can see, that's the lesser omentum over here. And this is the lesser sac. Behind the lesser omentum, behind the stomach. And obliterated here by fusion of the four layers of the greater omentum. Now this is a recess. That's the superior recess. This is known as superior recess. lesser inferior recess. These are the recesses or potential spaces or which are formed because of the deflection of the. Similarly, you get around the duodenum digeflection. When the that's the duodenum, and duodenum is retroperitoneal, jejunum is intraperitoneal, and there are fossas over here which are known as duodenal fossas, superior, inferior, and these fossas are nothing but the potential spaces where a loop of the gut can go. They are shallow fossas due to structures which was retroperitoneal, that was duodenum, becoming intraperitoneal. Similarly, you got recesses around the ileocecal junction, where the ileum is intraperitoneal, and the cecum and ascending colon becomes retroperitoneal. So wherever there is a change of direction of the peritoneum because of the some organ at this junction becoming intra or extra peritoneum, you get certain fossas which are known as, these are known as paracecal fossas, these are known as the peritoneal fossa. So this completes our lecture on the peritoneal folds and recesses. We'll continue with the peritoneum in the next series. Thank you.